I probably need to repent. I tell people routinely that I don't cry. I just have bad allergies. And that's a fib. Now, Don said something last night that has gotten me to thinking. There you are, Don. He mentioned being among the youngest on this panel. I think I probably even have Don beat on that. But if you'll give me about 2 minutes, something dawned on me about this panel and about the speakers this weekend. Every one of them has impacted my life, you know, either taught me or encouraged me, strengthened me, benefited me. Don and I went through school together for at least 1 year at Memphis, and at that time we sat at the feet of Brother Mosier. I've learned from Brother Taylor and his writings and so much of his encouragement through the years. So much encouragement. Brother B.J. Clark and Brother Glenn Colley are men that I have looked up to and that I have benefited from greatly. Tell you a story about B.J. He may not know this. I was in a meeting one time somewhere and Cade was with me. I think it was a meeting. It's Cade, my son. He was young, about 11 or 12. Those allergies are terrible. I hate allergies. Anyway, something came up about Cade's favorite preacher. And my being his dad, I thought he was going to say Cliff, you know. He said, yeah. He says, I think B.J. Clark's my favorite preacher. And it didn't make me cry. I wasn't that disappointed. But I really thought, I said, you know what, if your 12-year-old son thinks B.J. Clark is his favorite preacher, we're doing all right. And then two others. Wade may not remember this, but I need some Zyrtec or something. Wade may not remember this, but I remember sitting in his office. Raising support. To go to Memphis School of Preaching. And if it wasn't for Brother Larry Acuff, I wouldn't be here probably on this lectureship. It's a long story, but I went to preach at West Georgia. Brother Larry Acuff was at West Georgia. If it hadn't been for that, I wouldn't have gone to Detroit, Michigan. If it hadn't been for Detroit, Michigan, I wouldn't have met Joe Bloomberg. Joe Bloomberg's father was here in Western Kentucky. And from there, eventually I wound up at Sunny Slope. Wade mentioned the turtle on the fence post. Anytime you see a turtle on a fence post, he didn't get there by himself. And the expression we learned in school, Don, was we stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before us. All right, let's preach for a little bit. Open your Bibles with me to Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4. Where doubts arise. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. I'm really thankful that I got that portion of the song, where doubts arise. And I want us to divide our study. I have our glasses too, so you better watch out now. I have glasses today. I really want us to divide our study into three parts. Number one, we're going to talk about the danger of doubts. Number two, we're going to talk about the origin of doubts. And then number three, I want us to conclude by noticing the answer to doubts. And that's probably the most important portion of this study. For number one, the danger of doubts. Now, I want to differentiate between doubts and questions. It is not bad for Christians, children of God, male or female, young or old, it is not bad for children of God to have questions. In fact, I do believe that one of the major ways that we stretch and we grow and we develop and we mature spiritually is by asking questions and then pursuing biblical answers to those questions. And there are so many things about the Bible, so many things about the Word of God that I will frankly tell you, I do not understand. So many things that I do not know. And so I still have questions. Questions are good with this caveat. Mind the attitude with which you ask questions. When we begin questioning God, which is not altogether bad, when we begin questioning what His Word teaches and what it means, that's good. So long as we mind our attitude. I am the creature questioning the Creator humbly and in reverence. Questions can be good. Doubts, we're differentiating here today. Doubts are different. I'm using the term doubts as I'm pulling that word out of the song. I'm using the term doubts in the sense of looking at what the Bible says. The Bible clearly addresses this, or it treats that. The Bible says this, and I read what the Bible says, and then I doubt. That's more than a question. I have God's word on the matter, but, and that's all you need to say is but. I have God's word on the matter, but, and that's bad. Okay, so let's talk about the danger of doubts. If you're with me in Romans chapter 4 and verse 20, we have the Greek word that is in other places translated doubteth or wavereth, something to that effect. But here it is said of Abraham. Verse 20, Abraham, he staggered. Circle the word staggered. That's the word doubt. He staggered not. He doubted not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. The reason that doubts, as we're using that term presently and as we're addressing this matter today, the reason that doubts are indeed dangerous is because they are set in opposition to faith. See that in the verse? Two different indicators show us this opposition. He staggered not. He doubted not at the promise of God through unbelief. Indicator number one. What would this doubting have equated? It would have equated unbelief. And then indicator number two. But he was strong in faith. The opposite. And so the reason doubts are dangerous is because, biblically speaking, doubts are set in opposition to faith. Faith is taking God at His word and acting accordingly. I love that for a layman's working definition of faith. Now, if you want to get technical, you can say it's the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And that's God's definition right out of Scripture. You can't improve upon that for a technical definition. But for a working definition of biblical faith, it is taking God at His word and acting accordingly. Doubts are in opposition to that. Now, that's dangerous because what do we remember from Hebrews 11 and verse 6? But without faith, it is what? Impossible. It is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must, number one, believe two primary fundamental things. Number one, that God exists. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, number one, but that's not enough. A lot of people believe that. And number two, that he is a rewarder of him or them that diligently seek him. He does exist, but he's a God who's interested. He does exist, but he's a God who's connected. He exists, but he's a God who calls men into account, and he wants us to diligently seek him. We've got to believe these things. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Therefore, doubt, set in opposition to faith, doubt is dangerous. Now, turn over with me to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. James is telling his readers, if any of you, verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. So this is a statement concerning prayer. James oftentimes, when he's dealing with prayer, he will use the verb ask. He might not use the verb pray, but he's talking about praying. Ask. Chapter 4, ye have not because ye ask not. And here he uses the word ask, but he's talking about prayer. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. So here's a statement about prayer. But notice what is damaging to our prayer lives, verse 6. But let him ask in faith. There's the antithesis. There's the contrast. Faith. Nothing, old King James says, wavering. It's the same verb as staggered from Romans 4:20. Doubts. Let him ask in faith, nothing doubting. For he that wavereth, he that doubteth, is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. And then James says, for let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. How terrible. How terrible for one's prayer life to be nullified. For one's prayer life to be made essentially void. Why? Because of doubts. Doubts are dangerous. They're dangerous because they are set in opposition to faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. They're dangerous because they undermine and ruin one's prayer life. How would you like to try to go to heaven without the ability to effectively pray? It's dangerous. And all of this is because our doubts cast a reflection on two things at least. Our doubts cast a reflection on the Word of God, and they cast a reflection on the God of the Word. If you and I are doubting when the Bible clearly teaches us something, and we say, yeah, I know the Bible says this, but then you're casting a reflection on the Word of God. Where does faith come from? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. This Word is to produce and feed and nurture my faith. But only if I accept it, only if I welcome or receive it. The Greek word for welcome or receive rather means to welcome into our hearts in many places. Acts 2 and verse 41 and in other passages as well. And so it's a poor reflection on the Word of God if I choose to doubt what God has clearly said. But now perhaps even worse, it's a poor reflection on the God of the Word. Because God's given me His Word and I've read it and I know it. And I reply, but... And Paul says, oh, I had an elder one time. He used to quote this, Romans 3:4. He says, let God be true, but every man a liar. There's no buts. If God said it, God meant it. God's true. And if there's no buts, and if God is true and every man a liar, guess what? Where that puts my doubts? My doubts are not good. They're dangerous. All right, that's point number one. Point number two now, let's move on and talk about the origin of doubts. From whence do doubts come? From whence do doubts arise, as we sing in the hymn? Well, probably a number of places. I've chosen three specific origins that I want us to be aware of. Number one, go with me. Let me read the text before I give you this. Go with me to Genesis chapter 3, all the way back to the dawn of creation. I believe, my opinion, I believe this occurred not very long, in fact, probably, after God had created the initial pair, placing them in the Garden of Eden. Genesis chapter 3, we have the devil's coming to Mother Eve in the form of the serpent. And after the woman says, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, verse 2, the fruit of one particular tree, verse 3, we shall not eat of it. Notice the devil says, verse 4, the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Now that's the great lie. But now put verse 5 with it. The devil continued, "For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." The late Brother Franklin Camp, in preaching on this text, he used a terminology that I'm going to use here today. Origin number one of doubts is what the late Brother Camp called the power of evil suggestion. Evil suggestion. In the South and in other cultures, I suppose as well, we have an expression about planting a seed. You know, we even call it planting a seed of what? Of doubt, oftentimes. Planting a little seed of doubt. And here we can think of that as evil suggestion. The devil comes on the scene, and with Mother Eve, he poses an evil suggestion. He gets Mother Eve to thinking suspiciously about God. Oh, God's keeping something from you. God has essentially lied to you, the devil is insinuating. God is not wanting you to have something. He's not wanting you to enjoy something. And the devil plants that evil seed, the seed of doubt, evil suggestion. Now let me throw this in right here. Brother or sister, listen to me please. It might be people with whom you work. It might be people in your community. It might be people in your family, extended or immediate family. It might be people with whom you enjoy leisure time or hobbies, but people who make little statements and who plant seeds of doubt, you need to get those people out of your lives. Okay, now first, by all means, talk to them and tell them you know what's happening. You recognize what they're doing. Well, they may not even recognize it. Now, let's give them the benefit of the doubt. This may be in their makeup, their personality. It may be coming from their lack of spirituality or whatnot. But you tell them, look, I've recognized that the statements you make and the influence you've been having on me is not beneficial for my spiritual health. And I'm going to have to ask you to stop it or our relationship is going to end. Because I do not need seeds of doubt planted in my heart through evil suggestion. Okay? I don't intend at all to think suspiciously toward my God. I know my God. I'm not going to think suspiciously toward Him as Satan caused Mother Eve to do in the beginning. Evil suggestion. Now, we won't read it, but another example of such, if you want to write this down, comes to us from 2 Samuel chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. You remember that Nahash, the king of the Ammonites, had died, and David wanted to show kindness to his son Hanan, because Nahash had apparently shown kindness to David. And so David sent an ambassage, if you will. He sent envoys to Hanan, apparently the heir apparent there over the Ammonites. And what did the princes of the Ammonites do? By way of evil suggestion, they poisoned Hanan's thoughts and Hanan's attitude toward David. And they said, David doesn't really care about you and your grief. David has sent these men as spies. And it caused a war. A war that no doubt the children of Ammon regretted. The power of evil suggestion. If you have doubts in your heart and in your life toward the Word of God and toward the God of the Word, look at your life and see if there are those who are planting seeds of doubt through evil suggestion. Number two, very quickly, another origin of doubt is what we might call academic intimidation. Academic intimidation. Now, I forget the name of the movie. I don't know the name of the movie now. Might have been Matilda. But anyway, in that movie, you know, the dad is telling the little girl, I'm big, you're little, I'm smart, you're dumb, I'm this, you're that. You know, the attitude sometimes of the intellectually elite is pretty close to that right there. I'm smart, you're dumb. I'm big, you're little. You shut up, you listen to me. Now, I said this last night. I respect education. Education can be a good thing, but my daddy taught me growing up that there can be those who are educated beyond their intelligence. Okay, and I'm not being ugly. I'm just telling it like it is. You get someone educated to the point that they don't need God, they think. Someone educated to the point that they say they know there's no God. That person has passed right over into that realm. He's been educated beyond the bounds of his own intelligence. And I will not be intimidated by someone simply because they have more education than I do. I respect education, but I tell you what, you can be educated in every discipline in academia, and if you're ignorant of the Bible, I love you, but you're ignorant. Ignorance of the Bible is the greatest ignorance known to mankind. Go with me quickly to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 17. And in Acts chapter 17, Paul found himself facing the intelligentsia of his day. He found himself in one of the three intellectual centers of the first century world. Now, Athens at this point had already been in decline. And now it's being rivaled by Alexandria down in Egypt. It's being rivaled by Tarsus over in Cilicia. But guess what? Paul was from Tarsus. And guess what? Paul had gone to Jerusalem and had grown up in Jerusalem and had grown up at the feet of a great rabbi, a great teacher. But guess what? Even more, Galatians 1 and verse 12, Paul had received the revelation of Jesus Christ, and that's what it took. And he stood toe-to-toe there in Mars Hill, or before the Areopagus, and I think that's probably the preferable understanding, more of a council than a location probably. And in Acts 17 and verse 18, these educated men, in fact, these were the leaders of the educated in some respects, then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, "What will this babbler, what will this seed picker say?" Other some, "He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." Notice this condescension, this condescending attitude. He's a seed picker. He's a babbler. What's he got to say to us? Academic intimidation. And then you read on, you move down through the breadth of Paul's sermon, and you come to verse 32 in Acts 17. "And when they had heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked." They scoffed and made ridicule. Others said, "We will hear thee again of this matter." You know what? They might have been academically intimidating, but they were not intimidating to the Apostle Paul. At least I hope not. The record I have right here is he stood up and he told the truth. He preached the message of God's word. And I'll tell you what, it wasn't unsuccessful. I regret that so many commentators, in commenting on Acts 17, they act like his efforts in Athens were a failure. Friends, that's false. There were souls saved in Athens. How many needed to be saved in order for it to be a success? And actually, you could do this. Anytime the truth is preached so that on the day of judgment it's a matter of public record, you heard the truth, that's successful. Men and women might reject it and be lost, but you know what? They had opportunity. And that's a success in and of itself. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, before we leave this idea of academic intimidation, Paul, in writing 1 Corinthians 1 at 18, he said, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written," God says this now, and you can mark this down, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent." Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? To our young people in the audience, we have a number of young people, please hear me. If you have the opportunity in the near future or not so near future and you go off to college and you receive higher education, do not be intimidated by godless professors who don't know anything about this book. Do not let them bully you. Do not let them intimidate you. Paul asks, where is the wise? He cannot stand before God. Where is the scribe? He cannot stand before the word of God. The origin of doubt for so many is academic intimidation. Men educated beyond the bounds of their own intelligence and then force-feeding our young people, telling them how foolish it is to believe in the Bible, how archaic it is to believe in the God of the Bible. That's rubbish. That's rubbish. Do not be intimidated. And then finally, under this heading, the origin of doubts, number three, misplaced focus. Sometimes brothers and sisters begin doubting the Word of God. They begin doubting. You know, the God's Word says, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Well, God, I know that, but. And the reason they begin doubting is a misplaced focus. It's more of an egocentric focus, a focus on themselves, their own lives, their own circumstances, instead of a theocentric focus, a focus on God. Now, this is hard for all of us, and any of us can fall into this trap, okay? But the fact of the matter is, if we become focused on external circumstances around us, you know, the wicked's prospering or the wicked's advancing, my own health problems or my own troubles and trials or the state of our nation, if we start focusing on externals, we're not doing 2 Corinthians 5:7. For we walk by faith, not by sight. You know what I can see? I can see, and I'll just tell you my opinion. Our nation has gone downhill a long ways in my lifetime. I remember growing up in the 80s, and we're not in the same United States that we were in the 80s. But if I focus on the externals, I'm focusing on what I can see. And Paul says we don't focus. We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. That's theocentric. That centers on God, theos, not egocentric. It's not focused on me. Mistaken focus, misplaced focus is the cause for some doubts. Now, maybe the best remedy for this is found in Psalm 73. So turn there really quickly with me. Psalm 73, is that in the Old Testament? It is, right? Psalm 73. Look at verse 1. Here the psalmist begins verse 1. Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But now notice that the psalmist admits, but as for me, he says, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. Brother, what had happened to you? He says, because I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. He said, I was looking around at people round about me, and he says, I got my focus off of God. I quit focusing on God and what God has told me is true, what God has told me will happen, and I started focusing on my external circumstances, and he began having doubts, apparently. And then you move down there to verse 16 in this psalm. He says, when I thought to know this, he says, it was too painful for me. If I think about our nation very long, it gets painful for me. Verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God, he says, and then I understood their end. Do you know what relieved the doubts of the psalmist? He needed to get back to God. He needed to get back to the house of God. He needed to get back to the revelation, the Word of God. Misplaced focus is another origin of our doubts. All right, finally, and my time's fleeting, but point number three, very quickly, the answer to doubts. We've noticed the danger of doubts. We've noticed the origin of doubts. Now, what's the answer? Preacher, what can I do? I'll frankly tell you that I struggle with this. What can I do? Here's some things we all can do. Number one, feed your faith. Feed your faith. Jesus said in Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Where does faith come from? Romans 10:17. It comes from hearing the word of God. We need to spend more time in the book if we're combating doubts. Feed your faith. Number two is a compliment to it. Starve your doubts. I'm the world's worst at this, okay? I'm preaching to myself. But we can sit around and we can fixate and we can just roll over in our minds over and over problems that we're thinking about or perhaps doubts that we're battling. Don't do that. What did Paul tell us to do in Philippians chapter 4 in verse 8? He says, what I want you to do is I want you to think on particular things. I want you to think on things that are true and honest and just and pure and lovely and of good report. Some call it cognitive behavioral therapy. That relates to this. But we have to be deliberate in what we focus upon, what we occupy our minds with, and on the basis of Philippians 4:8 and other texts, starve your doubts. Feed your faith, starve your doubts. Number three, consider the source. Now this relates back to those who would plant seeds of evil suggestion. You look at your life, and if there's individuals in your life who are saying things or posing things that is hurting your faith, you need to consider the source. Where's that coming from? Look at him or her, and you know, is this a person that has their spiritual life together? I'm going to say probably not. Why are you letting someone whose own spiritual life is in shambles, why are you letting them say things that get under your skin and that plant doubts in your heart? Consider the source. Number four, you go to brothers and sisters with whom you can strengthen your hand in God. That is a marvelous statement said of Jonathan and David in 1 Samuel 23:16. Jonathan went out and he met David, as I recall, I think it was in a woods. And the Bible says that he strengthened his hand in God. The wonderful thing about the Lord's church is we're a family. The thing is that if I'm having doubts, if I'm having struggles, I'm not the Lone Ranger. I'm not the only one this has ever happened to. I need to find a faithful brother. I need to find a faithful sister. I need to find someone perhaps older in years, older in the faith, and I need to go find someone with whom I can strengthen my hand in God's hand. Do that. And you find something similar in Malachi 3. In verse 16, and then number five, and finally, and this is a hard pill to swallow now. I saved the hardest for last. But if you want to answer doubt, it may simply involve humbling yourself. You know, according to Deuteronomy 29:29, you and I were not supposed to know everything. And sometimes things are going to happen and we're not going to know why. Sometimes we're going to have questions that at least on this side of eternity will not find answers. We may just need to humble ourselves, placing ourselves in God's gracious hand and saying, Father, I'm yours. I believe in you and I trust in you and nothing is ever going to change that. And I just want to humble myself before you. You know, Job had to learn that in Job 38. Job had it rough. But when God called Job on the carpet, Job 38:1-3, very quickly, Job learned to humble himself and to back up and say, you know what, I'm not going to doubt God. I'm not going to doubt God's integrity. I'm not going to doubt God's wisdom. I'm not going to doubt God's righteousness. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Thank you.